As we get ready for the 2024 fantasy football season, we've been covering some of the top draft strategies to get you ready for your draft. Prior, we talked about robust RB, we talked about double hero RB, but now it's time to talk about hero RB so we can get a good idea of how to use the strategy to its fullest. If you've never used it before, if you've never heard of it before, this is a draft strategy where you draft one of the top running backs in the first couple rounds, usually the first two, three if you're stretching it out, and then you slam the other positions, mostly the wide receiver position, and you come back later in the draft at a certain point and you start drafting up running backs. That way you're deep at wide receiver, you're still good at running back, you're flexible at other positions, and you're taking advantage of the depth at the running back position, the backups, the streamers, and it's just another way to build teams throughout the draft. We're covering all the strategies as we lead up to your fantasy drafts so you get a good idea of what the market looks like in your league. So when a player well starts to dry up in your draft, you're aware of it, you know where to pivot, or if you accidentally start drafting a certain way due to values coming your way, say you drafted three running backs back to back to back, you weren't planning on it, now you know what's going to come up in the next few rounds, so you know to pivot to that other position right now, or you know how deep or how shallow certain position groups are going to be once you get later in the draft. But before we begin today, you need to click that subscribe button right now. We're covering these draft strategies up until the fantasy football season. We're helping you build your fantasy teams. We're going to help you win your draft. We're going to help you win the waiver wire, which is huge for all of these draft strategies going forward. And it will be on the daily in the season. We'll be talking about the waiver wire every single day from the top picks to the bottom picks for your deep leagues, your shallow leagues, whatever. Click that button. Stop missing out. Starting off, we're going to go round by round. We're going to use two sets of ADP. We're going to use Underdog ADP, FFPC ADP. That way we get a large sample. We're going to talk in the macro here. So if you're in a basic redraft league with your friends, coworkers, you can know that those guys are probably going to draft heavier at running back than compared to the guys at Underdog. But if you're drafting at Underdog, you want to look at this strategy, you got that as well. Or if you're in a league that drafts heavier at wide receiver, you can compare it, you can use it. But we're starting off here looking at the first round of Underdog Fantasy. Four running backs coming off the board and at different quadrants of the first round, which is great to see. So if you got the 101, more than likely you're going Christian McCaffrey anyway. So you might be going hero RB because when that turn happens, you're probably going wide receiver, unless a running back falls to you at value. If you're in the middle of the draft, you might have to forego one of those top wide receivers. You may not want to do so, but if you want to follow the strategy, Bijan and Breece Hall will be there in the back end of the draft on the snake there at the 112. You can go Jahmyr Gibbs, one of the other running backs getting drafted at the top of round two, and really get a good wide receiver and a good running back, which is good to see. When we look at the FFPC, it's very similar. FFPC, more traditional redraft, but it's higher stakes, bigger money on the line. But you will see some differences in ADP, some similarities. Breece Hall, Bijan Robinson, up the board a little bit more. Christian McCaffrey, Jahmyr Gibbs the same. So very similar in those regards, but how can we use this to our advantage from a macro standpoint is that we're seeing four running backs come off the board in the first round. We know where they're going, and if we want to go hero RB here, we have to grab one of them here or wait till the second or third round. That being said, there is some talent here in the second and third round that we can go after, and there's elite wide receivers here. If you want an elite wide receiver, you can grab one here and just wait for the other rounds. Not too bad. That might be the most optimal considering the fragility at the running back position, but wide receivers also deep. So you can grab one of those top running backs like a Bijan, a Christian McCaffrey, or a Breece Hall, and then move on and keep slamming the wide receiver position. It's how you want to play it. But we come down here to the second round. This is Underdog ADP. Devin Achane, Saquon Barkley, Jonathan Taylor. And in traditional redraft leagues with your friends, there's going to be more running backs, especially once we get to the end of training camp. That being said, Underdog, wide receiver zealots. It's wide receiver heavy there. But that's going to be like that in some other leagues as well. But what you can also say is you can grab your elite wide receiver. You can get a Saquon. You can get a Jonathan Taylor, a running back who's getting a lot of volume there. And then you're good to go, and you'll pound wide receiver after. So you're anchored at wide receiver and running back, and you're looking good. You can say the same thing with the FFPC. We got Saquon, Jonathan Taylor, Achane, Derrick Henry getting in there as he should, Travis Etienne. So we got more running backs. That looks more like a traditional redraft league when it comes to ADP. But again, we're talking in a macro standpoint. So you got some good running backs in the second round to look at. Again, like I said previously, there's two ways to look at this. You can grab an elite wide receiver, get one of those good running backs in the second round, pound out wide receiver, tight end, whatever's coming to you off the board. Then later in the draft, depending on how you feel about the running back position, the rate of your league, the whole macro environment of the player pool, you start going running back again. But it's how you want to play it. You can get that elite running back and then start slamming wide receivers and other positions as well. But when we look at the third round here, things get interesting here on Underdog. And Derrick Henry's in the third round here, second round of FFPC. Kyren Williams will probably leak into the second round of a lot of traditional redraft leagues as well. So be on the lookout for that. And then there'll probably be some other running backs jumping up. We still got some good wide receivers on the board. Something to take note, they are starting to tear off a little bit. And then you look at the third round of FFPC, Kyren Williams, Isaiah Pacheco, all good running back prospects. The running backs are starting to die down. They're starting to draft more wide receivers. But again, when we look at the player pool, you're more than likely going to want to draft your running back round one or round two. The second round of redraft right now is looking dicey, is not looking super good. I'm kind of scared off with it, especially with the fragility rate with the wide receivers seem to go up there with the running backs. Pick your poison with the running backs there. Or you want to start off with wide receiver there and get your elite running back in the start, go ahead. But I feel like third round later, you're probably slamming wide receiver and other positions there, even tight end. But we're going down to the fourth round here. Running backs, Zay Pacheco, Travis Etienne, they already came off the board in the FFPC. We'll see more running backs jump in. We'll cover those later. But FFPC here, Rashad White, Josh Jacobs, James Cook, more like your traditional redraft league. And why we're talking about the fourth round, even though we're looking at rounds one, two, and three, because some of these running backs, once we get done with training camp, are going to pump up ADP a little bit, especially traditional redraft leagues. So might as well go a round or two deeper. Talk about the macro, because if you're in a running back heavy league, then you want to learn about these running backs, where they could be, so you can implement that strategy. So we're looking at round three running backs. Some of these backs are going to be in round three. So you could go wide receiver, running back. But if you're looking to implement the strategy going into the draft, and you're really wanting to do this strategy, that might be a little bit harder to do. I think the second round might be great to get your running back at value, because you can get that elite anchor wide receiver, and then you can get a very good running back prospect with that, feel good at the top. The other thing, if you like Breece Hall, Bijan, or Christian McCaffrey, you really want them on your team, it's fine getting one of those three, slamming wide receiver, tight end, quarterback, whatever comes at you for the next 5 to 6 rounds, however deep you want to go with this, is also good to go. But when we look at this batch of running backs right here, rounds 1 through 5, adding Rashad White in, depending on what format you're playing in, and you're looking at the first 3 rounds of your draft, depending on heavy your league goes at running back, you got some options here. You got a lot of pivot points, the wide receiver. So looking at this, round 1, the first 3 backs, very good. They remain healthy. They can really take you to the championship if you hit the wide receiver spot. Round 2, if you add in the round 3 backs here listed, that's from Underdog. Usually, traditional redraft leagues will have more than those three running backs in at the running back position in round two. So you're looking at more running backs in that part of the draft. Round three, the round four backs, Travis Etienne, Pacheco. Travis Etienne might be going round two by that time, maybe with Pacheco as well, depending on what happens. Josh Jacobs, James Cook, Rashad White, maybe even a Joe Mixon might be bumping up the round three. Traditional basic redraft leagues, guys drafted on like ESPN, NFL, Yahoo, whatever. So again, you can grab one of these running backs as your main anchor. Maybe you can get lucky and get an anchor wide receiver, one of those elite guys. You might be able to get lucky and get elite production out of both wide receiver and running back if Saquon hits there in Philly. If that happens, Derrick Henry could hit in Baltimore. Kyren Williams, he's going to get touches till the wheels fall off. You could get elite production there. Travis Etienne, the offense still flowing. He had a good opportunity share last year, especially in the start of the season. Isaiah Pacheco and a very good offense. It's very safe and sound with him. You can play around with this draft strategy a lot. It's a very fun draft strategy to play around with because when you look at these wide receivers here, you got a lot to work with. Rounds 4 to 6 plus, a lot of talent. When you get around here, you're really wanting to slam wide receiver and get your wide receivers. Also, you want to look at the value at tight end. You don't want to overvalue tight end. You don't want to overvalue quarterback. You can get good value at the quarterback position late in your draft. It's not really about who there at quarterback, but when, because you can string quarterback throughout the season. That's not a necessity, really, unless you want one of the top quarterbacks in like the top 6 rounds, top 8 rounds of your draft. But after that, just play the values there. Once you feel icky at wide receiver and running back, you're good to start looking at quarterback. That's really the barometer there if you start feeling icky, but you can also stream quarterback as well. But round 4, you got some values. The red is like good values to get pop-off production. T. Higgins, George Pickens. T. Higgins, you're going to get good air yards and target share. George Pickens is going to get more opportunity. Marquise Brown's with the Chiefs now. Chris Godwin's going to get opportunity with Baker again. Deontay Johnson, new team, should get a 20%+ target share easy. That's round 6 plus draft capital, depending on the format you're playing in and who you're playing with. Rashee Rice may not get suspended. May not until next year. We shall see. It's not like we're legal experts, but we'll know more come August. We will, but that's good value considering he's been lighting it up at training camp and mini camp. But when you look at the thick of things here at wide receiver, you got a lot of value. But it does tear off after like round 6 or so. And then the running backs start to heat up around 6, 7, and 8. And they're very fun to look at here. Because round 6, Joe Mixon, Rashad White, I look for them to get drafted a little bit earlier than round 6 than what Underdog is saying. Kenneth Walker, though, around this area, and if you're feeling iffy, if you can't go too deep with this, round 6, round 7. You also, in this range, want to get somebody with some stability that's getting touches, that has a little bit of upside, so you feel a little bit safe. Guys, I like Dave Montgomery is good, gets you stable flatline production. Alvin Kamara is good in the passing game, especially for PPR. A great RB2 for your team. Aaron Jones is going to get volume in this offense. Raheem Mostert's even cheaper. He's going to be getting touches in a very high-powered Dolphins offense. Jonathan Brooks is the guy with upside here, the rookie, but could turn out to be a league winner, especially if he fires early like a top rookie should. Zamir White's going to be getting touches, a lot of volume. James Conner gives you flatline production with some upside. Round 9 is tearing off, but Devin Singletary is going to get workload. Brian Robinson always gets some workload. Tony Pollard, Tajay Spears, might want to just pick the cheaper one out of both those. But we get to round 10 through 14. And the strategy here is not just to try to pick the best guy, but honestly, you want to shoot for upside. You want to shoot for a running back that turns and burns very quickly, because we're not trying to draft the roster clogger here. We're not trying to draft the guy that we feel good because they're getting 8 to 10 points a game. We're also trying to draft the guy that could win our league. So you want to mix that up a little bit. You want to mix that with other positions. But once we get to those double-digit rounds, year 1, your two running backs. Those are the guys that are more likely to do this for you. Once you're your 3, 4, 5, 6, the jury's kind of out on you. The odds of you being a big splash, home run threat that's going to win the league for you, very slim. The guys who usually break out, break the league, become league winners, are the young guys. And especially if they flash a little bit, start to see more opportunity. And that's usually when you start to see the better values. But again, when you look at this list, if you want dependability, Gus Edwards, if he's healthy, Javonte Williams, still got the starting role, if he's healthy, Trey Benson, tons of upside. Round 11, Blake Corum, Chase Brown, both explosive, both getting opportunities. If you want cheap dependability, Ezekiel Elliott. Nick Chubb, if he's starting to look good in training camp, starting to get opportunities. Nick Chubb, though, nasty injury. Just watch the news. Just watch it. Jerome Ford might be a dependable guy late in double-digit rounds, but if we catch news on Nick Chubb, his value's gone up. Zach Charbonnet catches passes out of the backfield. He is much cheaper in drafts this year compared to last year. More obtainable. I like the price. Marshawn Lloyd, explosive in an explosive offense. Young running back. Ty Chandler has 4.3 speed. Can be explosive as well. Kendre Miller has been dabbling with injuries, but is very explosive. Kamani Vidal, another player in an offense where the running backs in front of him get hurt a little too often for your loving. So you may want to get him as a stash. Jaleel McLaughlin's used in the passing game. Now in rounds 14 plus, get guys who get you a complete upside. Chuba Hubbard's falling in drafts, but Brooks might start off on the pup. Hubbard might be getting opportunities early in the year. Ray Davis, a rookie who might be getting more opportunity than what's realized. Jalen Wright, 4.3 speed on a team that's very explosive. And again, you're just taking shots at the pinata. You're not trying to get right. You're trying to get lucky. You're trying to get lucky and win the league with these picks. And if these picks fizzle out quick, and you also want to be patient, that's the hard part, you start turning and burning with the waiver wire. This allows you to be more aggressive with the waiver wire because you've drafted guys large floor, large ceiling. If they're looking like they're hovering around the floor, that gives you more ability to move towards the waiver wire and be more aggressive. But using this strategy in a mock draft, I didn't hand pick them. I more like closed my eyes and picked around the ADP range. In this one, Amon-Ra, Jalen Waddle, Derrick Henry, T. Higgins, Marquise Brown, Evan Ingram, Alvin Kamara is when we started going running back again, Zamir White, Brian Robinson, Trevor Lawrence. The lineup, Trevor Lawrence, Derrick Henry, Alvin Kamara, Amon-Ra St. Brown, Jalen Waddle, T. Higgins. Strong at wide receiver, still feels very strong at running back. That's if you can land a good RB2 here. Again, we looked at that range. You look at the possibilities there. Trevor Lawrence at QB, so you went a little cheaper. Evan Ingram, solid tight end production there. Flex, Marquise Brown, Zamir White. This is a strong lineup. This might be too optimal. Looking at another one where Bijan Robinson got drafted in the first round at the 106 spot, and then Harriman wide receivers, Devontae Adams, DJ Moore, George Pickens, Chris Godwin, George Kittle, Jaxon Smith-Njigba, Joe Burrow, Tyler Lockett, and then we went deep with this so you can get an idea of what that feels like. Gus Edwards as your RB2. So in this situation, you're going ham on the running backs in the back half of your draft. Ezekiel Elliott, Marshawn Lloyd, Kendre Miller, Ray Davis, J.K. Dobbins, Khalil Herbert. You're trying to chase upside, trying to chase opportunity. You're trying to get lucky. And then also some of these running backs, a few weeks into the season, you're casting them away. You're playing the waiver wire, and that opens things up for you to do so because there's going to be running backs getting opportunity left and right that could splash, that could give you splash production, that could be a starter for 2 or 3 games, and now you feel better chasing that because you got upside running backs that you could just pick back up a few weeks down the road because they're not firing right now. So when you think about this draft, also think about your strategy for the waiver wire because that's going to give you a lot of opportunities going forward. And then when you look at this lineup here, Joe Burrow, Bijan Robinson, Gus Edwards, Devonta Adams, DJ Moore, George Pickens, George Kittle. We got the Georges, Chris Godwin, Jack Smith and Jigba, Tyler Lockett. You're streaming the running backs after that. You're solid up and down. And if Gus Edwards hits with the Chargers, you're going to be a nasty, nasty contender. And on top of that, if he doesn't, you can stream at the running back position. You're going to feel good going at the waiver wire. But looking at this, you're going to be very strong at running back at the top end because you're getting one of the top running backs. You're choosing to be a little weaker at RB2, but you could end up strong at RB2 as well because it doesn't end with your draft. And I can make the case that half your team is going to be wiped out by the middle of the season anyways, and you're going to be playing the waiver wire anyways, so you're kind of forcing yourself to be weak at a certain spot. Wide receiver is going to be super strong. Tight end should be strong as well. Quarterback really depends on how you want to strategize that. You got to gamble on injuries. Running backs are going to get hurt. It's the hurt business at the running back position. Running backs get hurt. That's why you're not getting too top heavy at running back due to the fragility at the position. Top running backs get hurt. They got a lot of work. They go down for a few weeks, if not for the whole season. Next thing you know, your top investment's out and you can pick up the backup or another backup and backfill the production. You cannot do the same thing at wide receiver because when a top tier wide receiver goes down, the targets just spread out within the offense usually. So the backup wide receiver, although people will tell you to run to the waiver wire to pick that guy up, isn't usually the optimal case because the targets just spread out. It's not vacated targets going all to one guy, to the wide receiver too. It just spreads around the offense. The offense gets slower. The passing game changes up. So it's different with wide receivers. That's why you're stashing a bunch of top tier wide receivers on the top end. But you got to be aggressive on the waiver wire to win this. You have to be aggressive with those back end running backs. You got to shoot for upside. You can't just get ho-hum productive running backs who are okay in the stat sheet, but okay doesn't win leagues, especially if you're looking for that home run swing. You do need one or two of those, but you also need to take shots at the pinata. I prefer an anchor wide receiver in rounds two or three, but on top of that, an anchor wide receiver in round one and then getting a good running back sounds pretty good now that I talk about it into the air in front of a camera. I grade this draft strategy a B, the highest of the last two draft strategies, because there's a lot of pivot points here. You can actually lean into double here RB too if the value is right in round three. You can actually lean into it. Say you come into your draft and you're like, hey, I'm going hero RB here. I feel like that's right for me. I studied the drafts. I mock draft a lot. And then you get into the third or fourth round and you're like, you know what? He's out of value. I'm drafting him. And then I slam wide receivers and I start drafting running backs again later. So you got a lot of pivot points. You got a lot of movement with your draft strategy here. But getting one good running back at the start and being strong everywhere else, and then allowing yourself the backfield with upside plays at running back and guys who are home run threats off the waiver wire, will probably win your league if everybody can stay healthy and if you pick the right guys. And at the end of the day, it's always about picking the right guys. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Make sure to hit that subscribe button on the way out. One thing for watching. Catch you on the next video.